The first time I ever got a wage packet with money in it was for being a mover of scenery between acts, between scenes at the Oxford Playhouse in England. I was a scene shifter, and that's the closest I ever got to my dream of being on the stage. The Lord Chancellor of England was once asked how he'd risen to the top of his chosen profession, the law. And he said it wasn't his chosen profession. He'd wanted always to be an actor. But he thought it better to go first to the law because it would be easier to go on the stage having failed at the bar than to the bar having failed on the stage. I used to think I might want to be an actor too, and I was early cured of it, and no one's ever asked me why I didn't become one. But writing in the end chose me. I didn't choose it. Rilke says that if you want to be a writer, you must ask yourself this one question. If you were told you couldn't do it, you weren't allowed to do it, could you go on living? If your answer to that is no, you'll be all right. But that must be the answer. It must be what you, not what you want or what you like, but what you need. It must be something you have to do. It must be your nature. And I'm very fortunate in having ended up doing the only thing that I'm fit to do, or competent to do, or ever wanted or wished really to do. So that's why the Oxford Playhouse interlude had been forgotten by me till you asked. The transition to me between reading books for boys and adult reading, so to say, was a once very famous book by Richard Llewellyn called How Green Was My Valley. As well as being a beautifully written book, it was the introduction, to me at any rate, of the existence of other societies and other people that I couldn't have guessed existed. Coal miners in one case and people who spoke Welsh in another. All of them living not very far away from where I was brought up, but it could have been on another planet. Very, very interesting and very decisive for me. Around the same time, I think, For Whom the Bell Tolls influenced me very greatly. And the early novels of George Orwell, not the political ones, but the social ones, about English life, coming up for air, keep the aspidistra flying, Clergyman's Daughter. Neglected, wrongly, I recommend them to anybody. Now that I have grown to the ripe age that I'm presently at, the magnificent 58-year-old mammal that you see before you, I've had the opportunity to test myself against writers who, instead of making you want to write, as those did, make you wonder why you bother and make you embarrassed at having ever tried. I'm talking about Pale Fire by Vladimir Nabokov. I am now talking about The Remembrance of Things Past, A la Recherche de Temps Perdu by Marcel Proust, things that appear not to have been written by human beings, books that give one, as reading Salman Rushdie does, the impression that perhaps people may have had when they saw Mozart and realized he wasn't composing music, he was just writing it down, he was hearing it, that it's not all done by hand, that there's something numinous and charismatic about the process. That's the company in which I now dare to spend some of my time. One might add to that list, which is not a long one, Middlemarch, of course, and Ulysses, and War and Peace, and I'd have to insist on Crime and Punishment. And of Salman's novels, Shame, The Satanic Verses, The Moor's Last Sigh, one of his less regarded but most magical and musical fictions.